Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. As the summer blazes on with record-breaking temperatures and a widespread outbreak of chronic swamp ass, PC gamers and DIY builders alike find themselves adrift and rudderless in a sea of discontent and uncertainty. For after the summer cometh the fall, typically a season of harvest and plenty, launch season where we the consumers gather the fruits and reap the benefits of progress thanks to research and development efforts made by hardware manufacturers big and small over the course of the year. But in recent years, it seems those fruits have dwindled and shriveled up into vaguely suggestive dangling appendages that are both unsightly and grossly overpriced. So what, we wonder, will the remaining portion of this year bring? Will we get the balls or the shaft, to put it bluntly, and which one is even preferable in this complex and overwrought analogy? The answer, of course, is a reach around. Just get a nice firm hold on one of these, an ice cold beverage of your choice to beat the summer heat and put off all those tough questions for another day. Besides, it's time for tech news. Cheers. Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair IQ Link System Hub, a single small controller that manages all of your system cooling and RGB lighting. The IQ Link System Hub mounts magnetically to your case and can control up to 14 devices, 7 per port, with daisy chain support so you can simplify your cable management while still enabling glorious synchronized RGB. Corsair's IQ software can automatically configure IQ Link components while enabling precise fan speed control and real-time system monitoring. Click the sponsor link in the video description for more on the Corsair IQ Link System Hub. For months, if not years, my fellow tech reviewers and I have been hammering one point home. Bang for the buck is the primary selling point for any new piece of PC hardware, GPUs in particular, and manufacturers have not been giving us bangs for our bucks, with GPUs in particular, for at least 2 or 3 launch cycles. The RTX 4060 Ti is laughable, the RTX 4080 is an insult, and even AMD's top tier parts like the 7900 XTX aren't far removed from Nvidia's greedy pricing schemes. No one should buy any of these components, per the recommendations of myself and my colleagues, and since we maintain such a vice-like grip on the purchasing predilections of the public, it's nice to check in on the fruits of our labors, as indicated by the monthly Steam hardware survey, which was just updated for July. We'll just go ahead and scroll down here and check video card description, and RTX 4. This is just a bit embarrassing. The RTX 4060 at nearly 1%. It is a laptop model. I'm not sure if that's better or worse. There's the 4090 because you got your whales out there. That's not unexpected. But look at this. The RTX 4070 Ti, the RTX 4070, and the RTX 4080 are all on the upswing. And look at this, much to my chagrin and disappointment, nary 2 months past its launch debut, the RTX 4060 Ti leapfrogging past much more advisable alternatives like the RX 6750 XT and the RX 6650 XT. I guess we do at least have a showing for the Radeon RX 7900 XTX, which has clawed its way up out of the other category. Honestly, how is AMD's poor Radeon team supposed to even manage more than their sub 10% representation here unless GPU buyers do a better job shopping? Specifically, by listening to the deranged rantings of people like me who already have way too many graphics cards on hand and yet still like to spend most of their time complaining about high GPU prices. Perhaps I should invest my time elsewhere, like in a series of home upgrade videos. Yes, I think I'll do that. Stupid Steam hardware survey. Speaking of stupid PC hardware and a lack of AMD GPUs, many who were disappointed with the debut of Nvidia's RTX 4060 and 4060 Ti looked over to Team Red to ask, "What have you got?" The top of this Steam survey still shows a huge amount of budget GPUs in operation, from the GTX 1650 all the way down to the venerable standby RX 580. So if the 4060 and 4060 Ti suck, wouldn't it be a great time for AMD to drop a mid-range GPU that does not suck? No, AMD seemed to say, the RX 7600 sucks enough for us already. At least that was the case before AMD's earnings call Tuesday, where Dr. Lisa Su proudly revealed more GPUs. Enthusiast class Radeon 7000 series GPUs, that is, which should launch in the third quarter, which is August and September according to Shire Reckoning. But what does enthusiast class even mean? Not Ultra Enthusiast, that's the 7900 series cards, but perhaps a step down from those would be reasonable if only an AMD partner would conveniently leak exactly what AMD has planned. Ah, PowerColor, thank you so much. When your GPU lineup is named after the literal embodiment of all things evil and heinous, I guess breaking an embargo isn't that big a deal, so oopsie, on Thursday, the AIB partner published details on their RX 7800 XT Red Devil video card, sporting the Navi 32 die that has been the missing child amongst the current 7000 series GPUs. Looks like cards based on this chip will feature 60 compute units, 3840 stream processors, a 2.5 GHz boost clock, and 16 GB of GDDR6 memory on a 256-bit bus. Similar in many respects to the China-exclusive RX 7900 GRE Golden Rabbit Edition that came out for $650 last week, but hopefully it will cost way less money and be available elsewhere than China. But Lisa said cards, not card, so will there be an RX 7700 XT on offer as well? I wouldn't be surprised, and I would also not be surprised if we yet again see perfectly viable video cards brought to market that are immediately DOA due to overly aggressive pricing. It has been a running theme this year. Another running theme this year has been the advancement and progress of AI, both in terms of development and real-world use cases. And while many AI users have breathed a sigh of relief as ChatGPT wrote their doctoral thesis or an image generator baked up a clickable thumbnail for them, others have been growing more concerned as AI threatens to replace them. But AI might not just be coming for your job, it might be coming for your GPU as well, as industry experts are beginning to point out. The threat is twofold. First, thanks to general-purpose AI capabilities built into existing gaming GPUs, such as the Tensor cores built into recent generations of NVIDIA GeForce cards, small-scale operations might find them to be more cost-effective and easier to source, depending on the use case, of course. A recent tweet from George Hotz, CEO of Comma AI, shows a haul of about 60 GPUs costing an estimated $60,000, which he purchased for his AI business. Back in the GPU crypto mining shortage days, many alleged that GPU makers would actually prefer to sell in bulk to mining operations due to the decreased overhead, and that would appear to be true when it comes to direct sales to AI firms as well, at least according to George's report. GPUs built specifically for AI, though, such as NVIDIA's H100 and H200, are already seeing a shortage situation, with prices ballooning in ways that bring tears of joy to Jensen's eyes, particularly in areas like China where demand is high and availability is low. But keep in mind, my friends, that NVIDIA's AI chips are still manufactured in the same fabs as their gaming GPUs, such as the H200, which uses TSMC's 4N node. And NVIDIA only negotiates so much fab time per year with TSMC. So when Jensen and company are deciding which chips to etch within those limits, do you think they'll opt for gaming GPUs to sell to the likes of us, who continually bitch and moan that prices aren't low enough? Or will they just produce more AI processors, which are going for $70,000 each for the last gen version and climbing? This is our concern, dude. Consumers, for example, likely can't get a $2.3 billion loan to buy new video cards by using their existing video cards as collateral, which is exactly what NVIDIA-backed cloud service provider CoreWeave did this past week. Our leverage is somewhat limited by comparison. We can hope for the best, I suppose, but what I really hope is that gaming graphics cards don't become second-tier choices for fab production, and that the closest we get to actually using a cutting-edge GPU is listening to AI-generated dubs of classic songs sung by Linus.
This no one dared to make a slip. A stranger there among them had with a big iron on his hip.
Yeehaw! Thankfully, though, AI tech is still years away from perfecting the light-speed data dump that is Tech Briefs, brought to you by Linus's AI Singing. Remember when DDR4 3200 memory was all the rage? It still is if you're on AM4, but apparently they produced a whole lot of those chips, so much so that it's being harvested and reused in new products. The DRAM spot market is apparently awash in gently used DDR4 3200 that's being desoldered from old server RAM sticks and then reused in consumer DIMMs that are being sold as new. The TrendForce report on this topic indicates that modules produced by Samsung and SK Hynix are most likely to be involved, and while we do appreciate recycling efforts wherever they're implemented, it would be nice if there was some way to easily determine if your new memory is actually recycled. RAM is volatile enough as it is. If you watched Tech News on May 7th, you already knew that AMD Zen 2 and older CPUs are vulnerable to voltage fault injection attacks that can defeat those irksome trusted platform modules and FTPM security devices. Here's a unique real-world exploit for that, though. Tesla vehicles that use AMD-based media control units, specifically third-gen MCU-Z variants, are actually built on a custom 12-nanometer Ryzen quad-core SoC that is Zen 2-based, which means it is vulnerable too. So a team of security researchers from TU Berlin used it to gain root permissions in Tesla's Linux software, essentially jailbreaking their car, meaning they could just turn on features that Tesla wants to charge you for, bypassing the $300 charge to turn on steering wheel and rear seat heating, for example, or go ahead and save $15,000 that you would have had to pay for full self-driving. Is full self-driving even out yet? Speaking of the AMD earnings report that I mentioned earlier in the show, AMD did that earlier this week, and while their revenue for Q2 was down 18% year over year, the PC market is on the downswing right now too, so poor results were expected. And AMD's results were less poor than expected, so they were actually good? Something like that. Don't worry, AMD has AI stuff in the works too, so I'm sure they'll bounce back and start neglecting their PC gaming customers just like Nvidia does. Consistency is important. Ending on some science news, there was quite a hubbub this week about a report that came out of China Monday. The physics department of Southeast University in Nanjing, China, claims to have synthesized a new material that can act as a superconductor at room temperature, dubbed LK-99. Superconductors allow electrical current to flow with no resistance, which is awesome in many ways, and LK-99 is made with a relatively common mineral called lead apatite, doped with a small number of copper atoms. Ease of production aside though, it was the superconductor at room temperature claim that led to the most excitement and skepticism, which was apparently warranted, as further investigation has revealed that LK-99 is a superconductor, but only at minus 163 degrees Celsius, which means the only true room temperature superconductor yet discovered is John Williams. He's a supercomposer too. I like ending on a John Williams joke. So there you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the description if you're interested. You can also check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.